It's day 30-something? Don't remember. It's like 35. This morning, woke up extra heavy. Scale read 249, so felt pretty full. Had I've kind of been bouncing around between like 5,000 and 6,000 calories, but I think I got to start hitting closer to 6 if I actually want to keep, like gaining weight by the day. That is the goal. So I'm going to finish this pre. Before I get to squats, I got to do the whole hamstring workout. And then should be a pretty good lift. Check the pump after. Should be pretty gnarly.
Same as normal. I'm going to start off with just a seated hamstring curl. But before I do any kind of hamstring curls, I always like to at least do a little bit of calves. Sometimes, like right in the back of my knee, like your fucking knee pit, you could say. If I don't warm up my calves, sometimes they can be a little bit tight. Take a few sets to kind of warm up. But even just light, like body weight stuff like this, just kind of bouncing around makes it feel a bit more comfortable for me. Hamstrings, definitely a neglected muscle group of the general public, at least. For the most part, anybody who's serious is gonna hit their hamstrings with at least close to the same amount of volume as quads. Obviously, quads has like squats and whatnot, so it won't be as intense, right? But, you'll still do the same amount of sets and like relative work. Because if you have just all quads and then the back of your leg is just lacking, it'll look pretty similar from the front, but looking at you from the side, you're just giving away thickness of your leg. You wouldn't only work your triceps, right? You're gonna work your biceps too, goddammit. So a lot of these sets, what I've been trying to do is sort of focus on the top of the movement, or like what you'd call like the peak contraction, right? So when my legs are all the way bent at the bottom, I'm really trying to get an extra squeeze instead of just kind of bouncing the weight around. Probably the easiest example for that is when you're doing bicep curls, right? You got the 20s or whatever, just as an example. You bring them up. And right when you get up to the top, just do an extra little pull. If you can't necessarily activate your biceps specifically, you just sort of imagine pulling your hand or your shoulder. Or in the case of hamstring curls, you imagine trying to pull your foot right to your fucking butt. Right at the bottom, just an extra little something or other. You should definitely be able to feel a difference in your sets. And if you have to go lighter to do that, don't go too light, but you'll definitely feel a difference. All right, let's turn this around again. Yeah. All right, so I said four sets of these. Looks like I lied. Probably gonna do another three at least. I don't really want to do RDLs today, just because I want to be extra strong on squats. I don't want to pre-exhaust my lower back. I'm going old school with a jug. If you've been watching the last few videos, you know I busted the other one, or at least I said I broke it. So I guess we're changing two things up. Got the old milk jug, and what the fuck is this? It's not orange. This isn't Tang. So this is just fucking Bert Kreischer style Kool-Aid, because you know. Intra-workout sugars, if you're bulking, not gonna hurt you. Plus extra calories. That's the whole point of trying to gain weight. You wanna drink take in as many calories as possible. And aminos, there's no aminos in here. Just eat your protein, take a protein shake. If you're buying pre-workout and everything else, those are legit. Like pre-workout, creatine, vitamins, food, of course, protein shakes. But the aminos, I think that's where you're just wasting your money. So let's get back into this, another three sets. I think I'll try the stack one more time. It's starting to feel pretty heavy. So that's seven sets, just standard, no drop set, nothing special of double leg hamstring curls. Super effective, but I'm gonna throw in some single leg now. So at least two sets of single leg, and then I'll see what I wanna do next. Still go pretty heavy, like this is a little less than half the stack. So just cause you're doing one arm at a time, or one leg at a time, doesn't mean that you're just going light. So, if by now you haven't at least considered the idea of doing squats, you know, if you're one of these anti-squat people, seriously take a second, look at yourself and ask honestly, do I really believe that I'm lifting optimally if I only want to do a leg press? But squat isn't that optimal? Or are you really saying, oh, I'm afraid to get under that much weight. I'm afraid to squat. It's scary. More often than not, that's probably the case, right? It's a goddamn trial. You know, you gotta overcome it. You gotta start squatting heavy. I definitely think that that's a separating factor, at least in the mindsets of lifters, right? You can go hard on chest, you can go hard on back, but going hard on legs, doing a legit squat set, that's what separates, you know, somebody down here from somebody up here. Where are all these people coming from? I mean, hamstrings pumped to hell, but you know, my general level of fatigue, it's not that crazy, right? Like, you know, I might be a little out of breath, but it's probably better to just finish off hamstrings, because when you move into a pressing movement, having a hamstring pump just makes it more comfortable. you know, you've already got some blood flow in the area. And then I kind of like to think of it as you get hamstrings out of the way just so you can go balls to the wall and quads, like destroy them. Because the quad part of your workout is going to be the most like tiring. So if I were to try to do hamstrings after a quad workout, pump probably wouldn't be the same. So before I get into any kind of squats, I always give them the leg extension real light. I maybe work up to like, I don't know, 100 pounds or so on each leg, just to kind of expose my knees, my tendons to a little bit of tension. I guess I get a little quad activation before I get into the pressing, but that's not really the point. It's mainly just about getting my knees warmed up. So I'll sit here for a little bit longer and then get into squats. I'm pretty sure the good squat racks just got sniped by a rogue group of lifters. So I'm gonna have to lift on the shitty rack. But it's not gonna stop me from putting up some crazy ass numbers. Well, definitely lucked out having this. Now that I think about it, this rack is in like the weirdest place. It's just out in the middle of nowhere. Not complaining though. If it weren't for this one, that is probably the absolute worst. If you have to wait for something, and typically I kind of have the mindset where I don't want to be locked in to a workout, right? Like if I'm doing chest and all the incline benches were taken, you know, I might do a chest machine or something. Like I'm not tied down to any specific lift, right? But with legs, I'm pretty much married to hitting squats first. So this is probably the only time that you'd catch me in the gym waiting for a piece of equipment. You know, other times I would try to find an alternative or maybe just come back to the exercise, but I definitely want to hit squats as the opener to quads. So Saved by the Bell with this freaking random rack. Maybe one lower. I really don't see why you wouldn't use safeties either. If you're doing legit squats, you know, or if you're a power lifter, whatever. I don't discriminate per se. But if you're going heavy, why would you fucking risk getting your head cut off by a fucking squat? It doesn't make any sense. So, well, if you see me squatting without safeties, or without spotters, if there's no safeties, that's a rare sight. And is ill-advised. I would not recommend it. Of course, now I gotta stretch out my chest because I'm freaking. My upper body is not very flexible. See if I set this up right. God damn, it's tight. Ugh. Jesus. That's freaky. I'm gonna view the tape, see if I should move the safeties.
Left adductor is feeling a little tight, but I think it's gonna be all right.
It's fucking high school mania in here. I'm not hating, I'm just saying that there's a very specific demographic of lifters all around me. Throw some fucking weight around. So I'd like to think that this is getting into the range of weight that you're not gonna see every day in your at your home gym. Alright. Gonna take a few minutes to get hype. And hit this shit. Holy shit. Alright, that was a good one, goddammit. Fuck. I had to take a few minutes to catch my breath. But, fuck, that's getting close to my lifetime PR as a set. The heaviest one I've ever done was 6 plates for 8 on the last bulk. So, we're only a month in, already up to 545, just give it a few more weeks. Oh. Ah. Let's see, is it gonna tip? Alright, I think one plate. Well, I don't know. Holy shit. See? You don't have to walk back and forth for every plate. Just do as many as one side can handle losing. And then move on. After reviewing the tape, the squats were a little high, maybe like 2 inches high. Not that it matters. I mean, still got a crazy stimulus. Not doing half reps, of course. But squats I typically like to take to parallel. I was definitely a little more freaked out for that set than normal. So I must have subconsciously tried to make it a little easier on myself. Like a fucking, let's just say a P-U-S-S-Y.
Okay, fuck.
Oh, dude. Holy crap. Oh. Shit, I fucking fried my adductors. Ooh. Alright, I'm gonna have to chill out on the pressing. God damn.
Oh.
Ooh. Fuck, the squats took a little more out of me than I expected. So. No pendulums. Machine leg press will still feel all right. So I'm thinking probably do like 5-ish sets of leg extensions, throw in some drop sets, and then get some machine leg press going. So this may come as sacrilege to some of you, especially those who, you know, are diehard squat supremacists. But if I'm being like completely honest, leg extensions are definitely the best quad exercise. Like if I were to just pick one movement for leg extensions, for legs, for quads specifically, it's gonna be leg extensions in all honesty. Like I love squats. I don't wanna skip doing squats. You know, they're fucking sweet. Go heavy as fuck, get strong, you know, expose the quads to some crazy tension. But leg extensions, I mean, it just makes sense, right? You're working your quad. So in a bodybuilding context, isolation is king. So I'm not saying that you shouldn't squat, the complete opposite, you definitely should. But if I were in a you know, life or death situation where I had to be hooked up to a lie detector test and somebody's asking me, what's the greatest movement for quads? I'm gonna have to say leg extensions. Leg extensions, definitely going fucking hard at the moment. I'll do one more set with a drop set of sissy squats. Then we're done. Check the pump, goddammit. Alright. Got the goddamn exposure down low. Standard procedure. If you wanna make your lighting look better in pictures and whatever else. Oh, just by feeling,
I am not exaggerating when I say that this feels like the greatest quad pump I've ever gotten in my life. Which, you know, if you're bulking continuously, that should be the goal, right? If you're getting bigger over time, then that would imply that every pump is getting crazier over time as well. Now, the squats definitely played a role, but I really have to attribute this to the leg extensions. Because sure, I did one bananas insane set of squats, but then followed it up by 10 fucking sweet sets of leg extensions. Now, I'm not gonna try to tell you that that's the greatest way to go about it. I gotta fucking catch my breath. But, you know, if you're doing triceps, right, you wouldn't argue with somebody if the only movement that they did was tricep pushdowns, right? And your quads, I mean, that's the triceps of your legs. All it's doing is taking your knee from here, or taking your leg from here to here. So quad extensions are pretty much perfect for that sort of stimulus. All right, so let's see what we're really looking like. Oh, dude. Oh. Oh. Holy shit, dude. Literally just standing, not even flexing. Like, oh my god. They're just fucking swollen to hell. All right. Let's see if there's any hamstrings going on. All right. Well, that's a pretty proud of myself for that leg day. As you should be at the end of every lift, right? As long as you achieve the goal that you set out to. Which for me, like I say, fucking, I've been saying this every lift now, is to number one, move some crazy ass weight, and number two, get a crazy ass pump. So both of those were achieved today for sure. So in terms of training, very successful. God, fuck. So calves every day. Today I did fed cardio. So typically I'll just do cardio fasted. Like I'll get up in the morning and just jump right on the bike after getting some caffeine. But today, you know, I did cardio around noon. So I ate a meal or two before. So I wouldn't recommend training a muscle while fasted. It's just not ideal, right? Because if you haven't eaten for a while, your body's gonna have less fuel from food floating around as like blood sugar and glucose or glycogen in your muscles and stuff. So if you were to work out fasted, you might run through, or you know, the bro science logic is you might run through your internal energy stores quicker. So you'll be a little more fatigued afterwards. You're not gonna be as strong. So muscles, you wanna train after you've eaten at least a few meals. But since I did fed cardio,
and I was already at the gym. I just did calves afterwards, which, you know, might not be the most ideal. Obviously, I wouldn't want to hit, like, legs after doing cardio. That'd be stupid. But calves, I don't know. I don't necessarily think that it's going to hinder you too much. But in all honesty, it's probably more effective to work all your muscles that you're going to during that day in the same session after a long period of time from the cardio, right? Because if you were to do cardio right before you work out, like let's say, I'll just get into this whole cardio speech. So if you were to do cardio right before you work out and then start lifting, for one thing, you just tired yourself out before your workout. So just from being like fatigued cardiovascularly, you know, you also burned some of your fucking fuel, you know, doing that cardio. Unless you're like full on keto, all you're doing is burning your muscle glycogen, right? Because that's your body's first go-to fuel source. So if you were to do cardio before a workout, you're just weakening your whole body. Your workout's not going to be as effective because you're going to be extra tired. Some other stuff about cortisol. You know, you don't necessarily want to do anything that raises your cortisol levels during your workout, which, you know, cardio is going to. That's a little bit too scientific for me to explain in detail. But whatever. Why would you want to tire yourself out before training? So doing cardio right before you lift is worst case scenario. Now, doing it directly after your lift, second worst. Because after you work out, right, after you've just fatigued your body and broke down your muscles, what do you want to do? Even if you're dieting and you're trying to lose weight, the first thing that you want to do after you work out is get a meal in, get some simple sugars in so that your body can instantly get a jump start on recovering itself, right? Even if you're on a diet and you're trying to stay below, you know, a certain number of calories, post-workout, if you get some simple sugars in instantly, it's just going to improve your recovery. Now, you might not necessarily notice it right away. You know, it's like taking vitamins. You're not necessarily going to feel different, but it's definitely going to be more beneficial. So, best case scenario, you do your cardio right when you wake up, right? Nothing crazy intense, you know, low intensity. Just 30 minutes, get a good sweat. That's what I do on the seated bike. And then, you know, afterwards, you eat your meals, wait a while. And by the time you're ready to lift, you're fully recovered. You wouldn't even feel that you did cardio. And then you're not in a stressed state. You know, you get right into your workout full of energy. And afterwards, you get to jump straight to rest and recovery. So, cardio, right in the morning, best case scenario. After you work out, not as good, but let's say you're busy. You know, let's say you got to get up early for work or something. You know, you don't have to try to, like, it's probably going to be better for you to just get a little bit extra sleep rather than try to wake up early and do the cardio. Because sleep is probably going to supersede the benefits of doing morning cardio versus post-workout cardio. But that's enough about that. So what the fuck was I just talking about? Shit. Working out, cardio, leg pump, post-workout meal. What the hell was I talking about? I don't fucking remember. Oh yeah, no, calves. Yeah, so I did calves in the morning. I don't have to do them now. I need to order some more dextrose. So dextrose is just like the simplest sugar that there is, right? There's a variety of different kinds of sugars. Like you've heard of fructose and glucose, or no, fructose and like sucrose, stuff like that. And those are all just different rearranges or arrangements of somebody posted a really good comment explaining it in an earlier video. But those are just different arrangements of individual carbohydrate molecules. I think he called them monosaccharides. That doesn't sound right. I'm pretty sure that's fats. But whatever. You know, fructose might be three sugar molecules connected. Sucrose might be two. I don't know. But dextrose is just the one. And it is just ready for your body to absorb. It skips a certain step in digestion, such that as soon as you take in like 50 grams, or any amount, but I'd say 50 grams post-workout is gonna be about what you want. As soon as you get that in your fucking body, instantly, you're gonna have an insulin spike. And what that's gonna do is it's gonna tell all your cells, hey man, we gotta take in some fucking nutrients, right? So all that sugar that you just took in, plus, I mean, you know, maybe do a little protein too, like a scoop of protein. All that shit is just gonna get sent to your fucking cells. Instantly jump your recovery. After a period of time, I'm not necessarily certain how wide of a gap it would put between two lifters if all other factors were the same, but it definitely would begin to diverge. Like the lifter who was doing that, rather than just, you know, not doing a post-workout shake at all, is definitely gonna get better gains over the long run, right? Now, it might not be that much at first, but the more that you can optimize your lifestyle and your diet and your sleep for training, you know, those little tiny changes and increments in your recovery, those are gonna add up over time. And that's what'll be able to separate you from the herd, right? Like, let's say you're a high school, college dude. How many of your lifter buddies do you know? Or let's say how many people at the gym do you think are taking their multivitamins? How many of them do you think are counting their macros? You know, how many of them do you think track their weight every day and try to, you know, correlate that with what they're eating and adjust accordingly? You know, how many of them are trying to look up different training styles and try to improve their methods? You know, probably not that many. So if you want to be serious, or at least if you want to improve your gains over time, you got to sort of look at each aspect that goes into lifting and try to optimize it for you. Now, you don't have to do this all at once. You know, I'm not telling you to start a 3-hour research binge, but you know, over time, try to, if you ever see some knowledge getting thrown about, or if you hear somebody talking in the gym about something or other, you know, try to take that into your mind, keep it in the, keep that forethought. And then, you know, if it sounds right, if somebody tells you something and your mind is thinking, you know what, that sounds right, that actually makes sense to me, maybe I should start doing that, then, you know, you gotta be open to that sort of new idea. Even if it goes against something you've been doing for like a long time, right? Let's say for whatever reason, when you do chest day, what you do is you start off with chest flies, really light, and just burn your chest out, get a crazy pump, and then you start bench pressing after you've already like pre-exhaust your chest, doing isolation movements, really light. You know, if you want to actually get stronger, somebody might get, you know, go up and tell you, hey, maybe you should just start off with the heavy stuff in the beginning, right? You're gonna be stronger, you'll be able to make more progress in terms of strength, which will correlate to size, because you'll be stronger on other movements as well. You know, just because you've been doing it a certain way, if someone explains something to you and it actually makes sense, you're not gonna be an asshole for thinking, ah shit, well, he's right, fuck. Well, I better change it up now if I wanna actually keep growing or keep progressing. That's kind of a rare situation, but overall message I'm trying to send is keep an open mind and try to accrue as much knowledge and information as you can. if you want to make serious progress over a long period of time. So nothing else to say. I mean, fucking legs got destroyed. Jug almost empty. This is 170 grams of carbs worth of Kool-Aid. You know, it might sound like an asshole for drinking that, but shit, I mean, simple sugars and your workout. If you're bulking, it's probably not going to hurt you. So that's all I got. Fucking proud of myself for that leg day. If you've been slacking on your squats, I'm going to find you. All right. Let's get the fuck out of here. I see you next time. God damn it.